theorem. Every subgroup of an abelian group is normal. This is what we have established. Every subgroup of abelian group is normal. That means if group is abelian, automatically every subgroup becomes normal subgroup. How to check whether any complex is subgroup or not? If it is finite, sufficient to prove A dot B belongs to H. If it is infinite, then we need to check A B inverse belongs to H. Now, is the converse true? That's what we are supposed to discuss. Take down this converse part. Every converse need not be true. Need not be true. What is meant by converse of this? That is, every subgroup of a group is normal does not imply group is abelian. Every subgroup is normal does not imply group is abelian. Example is, yesterday we have seen quaternion group. Very important. Try to remember this. We are asked to give a counter example where every subgroup is normal but the group is not abelian. This is the best example. Quaternion group, all its subgroups, namely, what are all the subgroups? This is where we closed yesterday, plus or minus 1, h1, h2 is singleton 1, h3 is equal to plus or minus 1, plus or minus I, h4, plus or minus 1, plus or minus j, h5, plus or minus 1, plus or minus k, h6, total g. So, all its subgroups are normal as index of H3, index of H4, index of H5 is equal to order of G by order of H, which is equal to 8 by 4, which is 2. So, every subgroup of index 2 is automatically normal. We have proved theorem yesterday. So, based on that, all these subgroups are normal. How about H2? H2 is trivial normal subgroup. Trivial normal subgroup. How about H6? H6 is every group is normal subgroup of itself. Yesterday we have discussed. This is what is called as improper subgroup. It is an improper normal subgroup. How about H1? Being center of the group is a normal subgroup. Every subgroup of it is normal, but the group is not abelian. But G comma dot is non-abelian. As I dot J not equal to J dot I. I dot J is K. Quaternion group J dot I is minus K. So, this is the best example of a group for which every subgroup is normal but the group is not abelian. This is the counter example for yesterday's theorem. Every subgroup of abelian group normal but converse need not be true. Next. Again, every subgroup of index 2 is normal. This we have proved yesterday. Again, for this also, converse need not be true. What is meant by converse? That is, subgroup is normal. What is meant by converse? Subgroup is a normal subgroup, does not imply index is true. Subgroup may be normal, If it is of index 2, definitely normal. Because it is normal, we cannot say index of that particular subgroup is 2. We cannot say that. Example, yes. In quaternion group, for example, in case of quaternion group, G is equal to plus r minus 1 plus r minus I j k. When you look at the normal subgroup, we know H is equal to 1 minus 1 comma 1 is a normal subgroup of G comma dot, but its index, how to find index? But index of H in G, IHG, is equal to order of G by order of H, 8 by 2 is 4, which is not 2. It is normal subgroup, but its index is not 2. So there can be a normal subgroup with index not equal to 2. But if it is of index 2, definitely normal. Index not 2 may be normal, may not be normal, need not be normal. We don't. Okay? This is the example where having index other than 2, it is normal. So this is again normal. Next. So with this we completed one. And also for this, you are convinced, okay, or you can have another proof here. Two proofs I have given already yesterday, but even then I am not satisfied. Every subgroup of index 2 is normal. If you find this better than those two, then you can see. So you are given G comma dot is a group, H is a subgroup, and what is given with the index 2. What is meant by index? Number of distinct left cosets and is equal to number of distinct right cosets. This implies number of distinct left cosets, number of distinct left cosets of H in G is equal to number of distinct right cosets is equal to distinct right cosets of H in G is equal to 2. There cannot be more than 2 left cosets, distinct left cosets. There cannot be more than 2 distinct right cosets. That's what index says. But what is to be proved? We have to prove H is normal. How to prove H is normal? Let us see. Now, let us take any element X in G, be arbitrary, some arbitrary element. See, H is a subgroup means it is only a subset. X is there in G. Every element in the set, superset, may or may not be there in the subset. H is only a subset of G. Where is X? X is in G. Therefore, X may be there in H, may not be there. Two cases arises. Every element of the group G may or may not be there in the subgroup. So this implies two cases arises, X may be there in H or X may not be there in H. Clear? Now suppose X is there in H. If X is there in H, then we have proved properties of cosets. H belongs to H if and only if H into H equal to small h into capital H equal to H. Applying that, this is if and only if Hx is equal to H, which is equal to xh. Do you agree? Now, hx is equal to, this implies hx is equal to xh. This implies hx is equal to xh for all x in g, as x is arbitrary. Just like that we have chosen. We have not assigned any value for this. This means every right coset is equal to every left coset. Yesterday we have proved NS condition, necessary and sufficiency condition for normal subgroup. H is normal if and only if each left coset equal to its corresponding right coset. So accordingly, this implies H is a normal subgroup of G comma dot by NS condition for normal subgroup. namely H is a normal subgroup if and only if each left coset is equal to its corresponding right coset. So according to this theorem, whenever left coset, each left coset equal to its corresponding right coset, it becomes automatically normal subgroup. Since hx equal to xh is satisfied for all x, each right coset is equal to each left coset, hence it becomes automatically a normal subgroup. This is case 1, if x is there in h. But you know that x may be there in h or may not be there in h. So suppose x is not there in h. If it is not there in h also, we have to prove h is normal. How to prove it is normal? Let us see here in this case. Now, again properties of cosets. We have proved properties of cosets, namely x is there in h if and only if hx is equal to h, which is equal to xh. This statement, because the statement is true, it is contra positive issue. That means if x does not belong to h, if and only if hx does not belong to h, and xh is not equal to h. Because statement is true both the sides. Because statement is true both the sides, we can say if it is there in h, these will be equal. If it is not there, they will not be equal, both the sides, because it is if and only if statement. X is not there in h implies hx is not equal to h and xh is also not equal to h. Next, we know e belongs to h implies he is equal to h, which is equal to eh. You have to take in that form. Hx equal to h, right side. Equal to comma. Actually, when we proved theorem, we proved like this. Separately only we have. I did not say R and anywhere. There, Hx equal to h. This also true, this also true. No, they are all actually, the theorem is like this. X is belonging to H if and only if this is one theorem. And another theorem is this. For our convenience sake, we have clubbed both. When it is true with right, equally it is true with left. So, what will be the contrapositive and if and only if part of the statement is, if and only if Hx is not equal to H, and x does not belong to h also implies, applying the same result, we get this. And also, one more thing, hx is equal to h, this is because these two are equal, and from the next theorem we got this, we clubbed these two saying that hx equal to h, which is equal to x. You can see the way we have proved the theorem. Hx equal to h we have proved first. So, xh equal to h similarly we stated. There are two different statements. Now, coming back to this, come back to this statement now. We know that E belongs to H because H is subgroup. Therefore, H into E is equal to H, which is equal to E into H. Therefore, Hx, comma H, what is H? H, E are two distinct, they are not equal. Not equal means H equal to H, E. One more. Hx not equal to h, what is h? He implies hx comma he are distinct right cosets of h in g. Since index is equal to 2, these two are the only right cosets. Not only these are two right cosets, they are the only possible right cosets, because index is 2, there cannot be more than two distinct right cosets. They are the only distinct right cosets. only distinct right cosines. Similarly, xh is equal to h, not equal to h, which is he, eh, because h equal to eh implies xh comma eh are two distinct left cosets, of h h. But we know index is 2. So, not only these two are distinct left cosets, they are the only left cosets. Because of that, why we are able to say only? Why? Because index is 2. Otherwise, there can be any number of distinct left cosets. But since index is 2, since index is equal to 2, xh, eh are the only distinct left cosets of h. So what? We know every group G is the union of all its distinct left cosets, all its distinct right cosets. So we should know what are all the distinct left cosets. But there are only two. We know what are they also. So applying that theorem, this is the area where we require these two are the only. Because unless we know all distinct left cosets, we cannot express group G as the union of left cosets or the union of right cosets. So there exists no other distinct left cosets, no other distinct right cosets, because its index is 2. Therefore, G is equal to Hx union H and is also equal to G is equal to xh union h, because every group G is union of its distinct left cosets and its distinct right cosets. So from these two we get which statement? So it's not equal to where? How can you say? We don't know. A not equal to B, then here B not equal to C, here we don't know about this. We cannot conclude. If they are equal, we can conclude. A equal to B, we don't know. Can be, but not necessarily. We don't know. So, what are all the possible cases you want, you take. Here they will be equal. So, therefore, we don't know. So, even though these two are not equal, there is a chance for these two to be equal. Sometimes that case is possible here. Why? Because index is 2. Using set theory. That is the reason why I did not make statement there. There is a chance. If A equal to B, B equal to C, you can say A equal to C. But if they are not equal, we have no right to conclude anything. Sometimes equal, sometimes not equal. But in this argument, it is equal. Why? Because index is 2. Because of this special case, they are equal. Otherwise, maybe what you said is correct. Maybe, may not be. Now, come back to this. Hx union H is equal to, therefore, xh union H. This implies, because G is equal to union of these two, so these two must be equal. Now, we know that they are distinct. Distinct means empty. This is nothing in common, nothing in common. Why? Because we know any two left or right cosets are either identical or disjoint. Either they are identical. If they are not identical, they must be disjoint. Not identical means here hx is not equal to h, they are not identical. Hence, they must be disjoint, property of cosets. Any two left or right cosets are either disjoint or they are identical. So, if they are not identical, they must be disjoint. Disjoint means intersection is empty set. Then, from set theory, we know If this is the condition, then this must be equal to this. So, what is the statement from set theory? A union B is equal to A union C, comma A intersection B is empty, A intersection C is empty, implies B is equal to C. You can refer your 10th class book, you have proved this as an exercise problem. So, whenever there is nothing common in between these two, nothing common between these two, and A union B is A union C, then B must be equal to C. Accordingly, Hx must be equal to Xh. This implies H is a normal subgroup by NS condition. These two are not equal, these two are not equal. So, Hx may be equal to Xh. In this case, it is so because of that result in set theory. Therefore, in any case, whether X is there in H or X is not there in H, if the index is 2, then each subgroup becomes normal. Where did we start? X in G. Every element in the superset may or may not be there in the subset. And we got that it is normal subgroup. I think this is a better proof out of the three. That's what I am feeling without any ambiguity. If you have still any ambiguity, you take any one of the three, whichever is convincing for you, you take that and then do it. Particularly this theorem. Every theorem we are not doing three times, but this is a special theorem where so many doubts you are having. Better, I thought. This is the one. Next one, let us quickly enter into next theorem. Take down this. We have proved earlier that intersection of two subgroups is always a subgroup. Union need not be. So, here take down this. Then what can you say about intersection of two normal subgroups? A very important theorem, repeated theorem. Intersection of two normal subgroups. Two normal subgroups of a group G is a normal subgroup. Intersection of two normal subgroups is always a normal subgroup. Union obviously need not be because union of two subgroups itself is not a subgroup. So, automatically it is not normal subgroup. Next, proof. Take two normal subgroups. Let G comma dot be the given group. And H and N be two normal subgroups of G comma dot, which implies number one, H comma N are subgroups, H and N are subgroups of G comma dot. Number two, H comma N are normal in G comma dot. So, give some number one for this. So, what is to be proved now? Intersection is normal subgroup. How to prove anything is normal subgroup? First, we have to prove that it is subgroup. So, to prove that intersection, H intersection N is normal subgroup, first we must establish that it is a subgroup. H is a subgroup, H comma N are subgroups from 1, subgroups from 1 implies H intersection N. Here, we know in some theorem, I have proved already, intersection of two subgroups is always a subgroup. We know H comma N are subgroups implies H intersection N is also a subgroup of G comma dot. Already proved. Now, it is already a subgroup. So, sufficient to prove that it is normal, it is satisfying normal condition. What is normal condition? Whenever we take X from G, H from whichever set you want to prove it as normal, X, H, X inverse must belong to the set which you want to prove it as normal. According to definition, recall the definition. When do we say H is normal subgroup? H is normal subgroup if and only if X, H, X inverse belongs to H for all X in G, for all H in capital. This is original definition. That means from now onwards, to prove anything is normal, suppose you want to prove H is normal subgroup of G, then from superset, for which you want to prove this as normal, from the superset we have to take X, from the set which you want to prove it as normal, H, small h, and X, H, X inverse should belong to the set which you want to prove as normal. So here instead of H, we have to prove for H intersection. So to prove that H intersection N is a normal subgroup of G comma dot, let X belongs to G, small h belongs to H intersection N, be arbitrary, some elements, just like. So this implies X is there in G. Now small h is there in the intersection means, according to set theory, H belongs to intersection means H is there in H and H is there in N. So H is there in H and H is there in N. Now X is there in G, H is there in H, comma H is a normal subgroup of G comma dot, implies by definition of normal subgroup, by definition of normal subgroup, X small h, X inverse belongs to capital H. What is normal subgroup definition? Whenever you take X from G, H from H, X, H, X inverse belongs to H. That's what the definition says. Similarly, X is there in G, H is there in N, comma, N is a normal subgroup of G comma dot, implies by definition of normal subgroup, X, H, X inverse also belongs to capital. Here, take care of commas. Comma speaks. So, here, X is there in G, H is there in H, comma. H is a normal subgroup. Because of all the three only, this is possible. So, now, X, H, X inverse belongs to H, comma, and X, H, X inverse belongs to N, implies X, H, X inverse belongs to H intersection N. By set theory definition, for all X in G, where did we start our journey? X in G, H in H intersection. As they are arbitrary, because we have chosen just like that, it is true for every. Therefore, H intersection N is a subgroup of G comma dot, comma, X, H, X inverse belongs to H intersection N for all X in G, comma, for all H in H intersection N, implies by definition of normal subgroup, H intersection N is also a normal of G comma dot. X intersection. Hello. Set theory. Yes, we can. Because intersection is associated. Intersection is associated. A intersection, you have proved in your 10th class, A intersection, B intersection, C equal to, you can change the brand, you can. But before going to that, you have to define what is H1 intersection H2. Every element in that, is of that particular form, you can prove from this side to that side, you can. Okay, but you have to prove that result which you are claiming, you must prove. Then only you can claim that, because in general it is not used, You can first prove that, then claim the result. Use that result for proving. Otherwise, you have to prove like this. Now come back to our next one. So we have proved earlier intersection is always subgroup. Union need not be. How about product? Product of two subgroups need not be subgroup. H is subgroup, K is subgroup. H dot K, that is product of two complexes. HK need not be subgroup. It is subgroup if and only if HK is equal to KH. Repeated question in the previous papers, we have done that also. So product of two subgroups in general not a subgroup, but it is a subgroup if and only if HK is equal to KH. We know that complexes need not be commutative. They are always associative, but they are not, need not be commutative. If they are commutative, then only the product is going to be a subgroup. Here, whereas intersection is always a subgroup. So now, in order to prove that the product of two normal subgroups is always a normal subgroup, we have to establish that they are always commutative. Because complexes in general are not commutative. H is subgroup, K is subgroup. Every subgroup is complex. We have seen earlier, HK need not be equal to KH. Complexes need not be commutative, but they are always associative. But if any one of them out of H and K, if H is subgroup, K is only complex, we cannot say HK equal to KH. But if any one of them out of these two is normal, automatically they will become commutative. That result we are going to establish here. In general, complexes need not be commutative. But whenever you take two complexes, out of them, one of them is normal subgroup, then automatically HK will be equal to KH. So that is the result we are going to establish. That means every normal subgroup is commutative with every complex. Every subgroup need not be commutative with complex. This itself may be given as a question. Like, is every subgroup commutative with every complex? If not, under what conditions? State and true the conditions under which it becomes commutative. So in general, complexes, no. Even if any one of them is subgroup also, no. Both are subgroups also, no. But any one of them is normal, then only yes. These are necessary and sufficient. So take down this theorem. If N is a normal subgroup of G comma dot comma H is a complex, need not be subgroup, just a complex, then Hn is equal to nH. That is, every normal subgroup of G commutes with every complex of G, with every complex every normal subgroup commutes with every complex. H and N are arbitrary, just like that we have taken. So you take any normal subgroup, any complex. What is complex means? Any non-empty subset. Any non-empty subset of a group is what is called as a complex of G. So every normal subgroup commutes with every complex of G. So take down the proof. What is given? N is a normal subgroup of G comma dot comma H is a complex of G comma dot. This implies N is also subset of G, H is also subset. And moreover, N is a subgroup, normal subgroup, H is just non-empty subset. What is to be proved? We have to prove that Hn is equal to nH. What is Hn by definition? By definition, Hn, how the product of two complexes is defined? Every element in this will be of the form two elements, that is product, where first element belongs to first set, second element belongs to. So every element in this will be in the form H into N, where small h belongs to capital H, small n belongs to. So when is an element going to be in Hn? An element will be there in Hn provided x can be expressed in the form product where first in order important, because remember these complexes, they can be matrices. These complexes, they can be elements of quaternion group, non-abelian. Then small h into n may not be equal to n into h. Therefore, we have to take care of the order. So, hn, small h into n, where first element belongs to first set, second element belongs to order, very important. Similarly, n into h is defined as every element in this will be of the form small n into h, where first element should belong to first set, second element should belong to this order, very important. If the group is commutative, automatically hn will be equal to nh. But whether the group is commutative or not, we are trying to establish, irrespective of that. So now, how to prove two sets are equal? To prove that two sets are equal, according to set theory, A equal to B if and only if A is subset of B and B is subset of B. So to prove that these two are equal, we have to prove that hn is subset of nh as well as nh is subset of hn. So to prove that hn is equal to nh, sufficient to prove that, sufficient to prove that, number one, hn is subset of nh and nh is subset of hn. Proof of one. Again, set theory. When do we say A is subset of B? If every element of A is an element of B, then only we can say A is subset of. So to prove that hn is subset of nh, we have to prove that every element of hn is an element of nh. So take an element x here, arbitrary element, try to prove that that arbitrary element is there in nh. So to prove that hn is subset of nh, let x belongs to hn be arbitrary, just like that, some element, arbitrary element. Then x belongs to, what is to be proved? We have to prove that x belongs to n. This is our goal. We started our journey here. Now we have to prove that x belongs to nh, then only we can say this is subset of this. Now x belongs to hn implies, by definition, x will be in which form? Small h into small n, where small h belongs to capital H, small n belongs to capital N. This is the information we are having. Now, we have to establish that it is there in NH now. When is an element going to be in NH? Provided X can be expressed in the form of two product, that is product of two elements. First element must belong to N, capital N. Second element must belong to H. Keep this in the mind. So to prove that x belongs to nh, we must be able to write x as product of two elements, where first element should belong to n, second element should belong to h. What is n? Normal subgroup. We have not used that anywhere. So that we have to use now. Now, we know x is there in h, h is subset of g, implies x is there in g. Do you agree? X is there in g, comma n is there in n, comma n is a normal subgroup of g, implies by definition of normal subgroup h n h inverse belongs to capital. Do you agree? Any contradictions? This is in which form? X belongs to g, n belongs to n, n is normal subgroup, x, h inverse, x inverse should belong to n by definition of normal subgroup. Instead of x here, what is the element we are having? H. It is also, give some number. Did we give a number anywhere? No. Number 1. Now, we know x is equal to hn, which can be rewritten as hne. Any objection? वही विच एक्सियम,
आइडेंटिटी एक्सियम। N dot E equal to N for all N in N. E in N.
How do you know E is there in N? Because N is normal subgroup. Identity must be there in N.
Now, in place of N, we are permitted to write N into E.
No objection, is it not?
Now, you can write this as H inverse into H.
Can we write?
Because where is H? In H. Where is H is subset of G, implies H is there in G. But we know H is a group.
So by inverse axiom,
there exists H inverse in G such that H into H inverse is equal to H inverse into H is equal to E. That means in place of E, we can write H inverse into H.
Agreed? Now,
H is there, H inverse is there in H, there in N, from 1, comma H is there in H, implies H, N, H inverse into H belongs to inverse by definition.
What is the definition of NH?
Whenever one element is there in N, another element is there in H, the product automatically belongs to NH.
Agreed? Any objection? Now,
this is there in N, already we stated from 1, and H is there in H, we already know, that's where we started our journey. So, the product automatically belongs to NH. This product will belong to this product. But what is this product? This is nothing but equal to from here, give some number 2, this is nothing but X. From 2, because from 2, x is equal to h n h inverse h. So, where did we start our journey? X is there in h n. Where did we end our journey? N h for all x. Where did we take our x? In h n. As x is arbitrary. So, we can say every element of HN is an element of NH. Therefore, HN is subset of NH.
We have proved. Now, second part. Proof of 2. What is to be proved now?
To prove that NH is subset of NH, HN, let X belongs to NH. This implies X will be in which form? Small n into small, where small n belongs to capital N, small h belongs to,
let this one be arbitrary. Now we have to prove that this belongs to HN. We have taken an element in NH, we have to prove that it is there in HN. When is an element going to be in HN? Provided again, it contains two parts. First part should belong to H, second part should belong to N. So, we must be able to write this in as product of two elements such that first element belongs to H, second element belongs to N. That is how we should be able to write this. So, now we know X can be rewritten as, now X can be rewritten as En, yes or no? Identity. Identity serves like bridge. So you can move from this side to that side to this side. Now, because this is by identity, N, En equal to N for all N in N. N being a subgroup, this is identity. Now you can rewrite this as H into H inverse. Any objection? Because H is there in H, which is subset of G, comma G, comma dot is a group, implies by inverse axiom there exists H inverse in G such that H into H inverse is equal to
H inverse into H is equal to. So in place of E, we have used here H into H. Now, look at this. Use this bracket, down bracket. This means we are regarding this as one single element, this as one element. Already we know this is there in H. This is there in H, we already know. We have to prove that now this element is there in N. Then automatically this product will be there in HN. That is the idea behind writing this like this. So give some number 3 funds. Use this bracket. This bracket means we are regarding this total as one single element. Down bracket. Now let us try to prove this. We know H inverse is there in G. From here, comma, N is there in N, comma, N is a normal subgroup of G, implies by definition, it is like our X. This is in which form? X is there in G, H is there in H, implies X, H, X inverse belongs to the set whichever is normal. So here N is normal. Definition of normal subgroup, we get an element X inverse into the element in N into its inverse belongs to H, belongs to, sorry, N, because N is normal subgroup. H is just a complex, H is not normal subgroup. So this is in the form X, H, X inverse. Do you agree? Any arguments? So this is an element in G. In place of X, we are having this. Definition says X, H, its inverse belongs to it. But we know property of group, H inverse in inverse is nothing but H. Because H inverse into inverse is equal to H for all X in H, which is subset of G. By property of group, inverse of inverse is itself. Now, H is there in H. H inverse NH is there in N implies by definition of HN, first element is there in H, second element is there in N. So by definition, H inverse NH automatically belongs to HN. Regard this, use this bracket. Whenever this is there in H, this is there in N. The product will belong to the product, that is what the definition says, HN. This implies, what is this element actually from here, from 3? This is nothing but X. So, X belongs to HN. This is from 3. So, where did we start our journey? X is there in NH and we got that it is there in HN. Therefore, X belongs to NH, automatically implies X belongs to HN for all X as X is arbitrary. Therefore, by set theory, this is subset of it. Therefore, HN is subset of NH and NH is subset of HN implies HN is equal to NH. Therefore, in the product, any one of them is normal and any other element is simply a complex, not even a subgroup, simply complex, then automatically it commutes. That is, every normal subgroup commutes with every complex of G. In general, complexes need not be commutative. Under what conditions it is commutative? Only when any one of them is normal subgroup. So, state and prove the conditions. You must be able to state the condition and establish this. So, take down this. Next. No. Normal itself means subgroup. Normal subgroup. Normal condition may be satisfied. But it has to be a subgroup. Then only we can talk about normal subgroup. We don't have any definition of normal complex. Okay. So, now, anyway, come back to this. If any one of them is subgroup, then can we say HN is subgroup. We have seen product of two subgroups need not be subgroup. But out of those two, any one of them happens to be normal. Both are subgroups, need not be subgroup. But any one of them happens to be normal subgroup, automatically the product becomes a subgroup. That is the next thing. So, if H is, N is a normal subgroup, N is a normal subgroup of G comma dot comma, H is a subgroup, just a subgroup, then HN and NH are subgroups, not normal subgroups, they are just subgroups.
We cannot say they are normal. So, this is theorem.
This is obvious, is it not? Given N is a normal subgroup of G comma dot comma H is a subgroup of G comma dot implies NH is equal to HN, because every normal subgroup, normal subgroup commutes with every complex, commutes with every complex of G comma. Okay. Now, N and H are subgroups, N comma H are subgroups. Actually, moreover, N is normal subgroup. Every normal subgroup is a subgroup. So, N comma H are subgroups comma NH is equal to HN implies HN comma NH, they are one and the same actually, are subgroups of G comma. Because necessary and sufficiency condition for product of two subgroups to be subgroup theorem. Because H comma K are subgroups, because since we know H comma K are subgroups of a group G comma dot, if and only if HK is equal to, very very important theorem, almost you can find in many papers this, HK is equal to KH. So, we know that product of two subgroups is subgroup if and only if they commute. We know that theorem. That means whenever they commute, product is subgroup. We know are subgroups of G comma, then HK is subgroup if and only if HK is subgroup if and only if HK is equal to K. That means whenever they commute, HK is subgroup. Whenever it is subgroup, they commute both the sides. Now that we could prove that they commute, NH is equal to HN, previous theorem. Because they commute, we can conclude by this theorem that automatically HK is a subgroup by converse part. So, they commute, HK is equal to KH model, therefore HK is subgroup. What is HK? It is nothing but KH. So, therefore both are subgroups of this by that theorem. By NS condition for product of two subgroups to be a subgroup theorem, we get this. Therefore, if N is a normal subgroup, that means in the product, if any one of them is normal subgroup and other is just a subgroup, it is complex, we cannot say it is subgroup, then product is subgroup. So, if one of them is normal subgroup, the other is complex, what we can say is the commute. But if one of them is normal subgroup, the other is not only complex, but is subgroup, we can say the product is subgroup. Where did we start our journey? N is normals of group, H is complex. Then what is the result we got? Hn equal to nh. Next, if n is normals of group, H is subgroup, then what did we get? Both are Hn and nh are subgroup. Then the next question comes, when are both product going to be normals of group? We have raised it from complex to subgroup level. Now subgroup to normal subgroup we have to raise now. Under what conditions the product becomes normal subgroup? That is going to be the next result. So, if n comma h are normal subgroups of g comma dot, then nh comma hn are normal subgroups of g comma dot. That is, product of two normal subgroups is always a normal subgroup. Product of two subgroups need not be subgroup. But product of two normal subgroups is always a normal subgroup. That's what this result says. So, take down the proof. What is given? Just take the statements as it is. Given n comma h are normal subgroups of g comma dot. This is what is given. This implies n comma h are subgroups of g comma dot. Also, which in turn implies n comma h are complexes. Complex means automatically a subset. That is, now n is a normal subgroup of G, comma H is a subgroup, implies we already know by previous theorem NH comma HN are subgroups. Because to prove anything is normal subgroup, first we must prove that they are subgroups. Both are normal subgroups, we have to prove. Also, we know NH is equal to H. We have established this. Whenever any one of them is normal, the other is complex, then NH equal to H. Already first theorem, opening theorem. So, because of that, N is normal subgroup, H is moreover a normal subgroup, every normal subgroup is a complex. So, every normal subgroup commutes with every complex. So, obviously, we get NH equal to HN. So, NH is subgroup, HN is subgroup. To prove that these two are normal subgroups, if we can prove any one of them is normal, the other will be normal, obviously, because they are one and the same. So, give some number 100. To prove that NH or HN anyone is a normal subgroup of G comma dot, sufficient to prove that. How to prove anything is normal? Sufficient to prove that X, H, X inverse belongs to NH for all X in G, for all H in whichever set you want to prove it as normal. From there we have to take, or to be on safe side, I will take x, y, x inverse notation. Otherwise somebody may object, why are you taking small h, already you are taking small h, is there in capital H, something like that. So let y be arbitrary. So let us take x, y, x inverse belongs to nh. Whenever you take x from superset, whenever you want to prove anything is normal subgroup, you take x from the superset, y from the set which you want to prove it as normal, then the product should belong to the set which you want to prove it as normal. This is what we have to establish now. If we can establish this result, theorem is proved. So let us take x in G, y in, where is y? Y in NH. You know how NH is defined. So let x belongs to G and y belongs to NH. Be arbitrary some elements. Now, y belongs to NH implies, according to definition, by definition of NH. How it is defined? Every element in NH is of the form product, where first element belongs to first set, second element belongs to second set. Now, what we have to prove? It is there in NH, we have to prove x, y, x inverse. Consider x, y, x inverse. Every step, don't forget what we have to prove. You try to put this question to yourself. What we have to prove? Where are we now? So, how to arrive at that? So, these are the questions every step you have to put, particularly normal subgroup theorems. You have never seen so many theorems in any chapter. From this chapter, you are getting theorems. This is x, y, x inverse now. We have to prove that it is there in NH. Not only that, problems are also in form of theorems only, particularly this chapter. Try to work out from that Joseph Galien, x, y, x inverse. So, this is equal to x. What is y? NH. Just I am substituting in place of y, NH. Now, this can be rewritten in the form E, because n into E equal to E into n equal to n. For all n in n, by identity axiom. Now you can again rewrite this in the form x inverse into x. If you have no objection, x is there in G, because x is there in G, comma G comma dot is a group, implies by inverse axiom there exists x inverse in G such that x inverse is equal to x inverse x equal to E. So, in place of E, we are licensed to write either x inverse or x inverse x. So, here in place of E, we can write now x inverse x. Now, this is in the form, use this bracket now, down bracket, xn x inverse, xh x inverse. Happy. Now, this gives some number, this is xy, x inverse. Give some number, what is the number? 2 for this. Now, we know x is there in G, n is there in N, comma n is a normal subgroup of G comma dot, implies x, n, x inverse belongs to G. Definition of normal subgroup. Sorry, N. Similarly, x is there in G, n is there in H, comma, H is a normal subgroup of G comma dot, implies x, n, x inverse belongs to H. Give some number, here 4, is it 4, 3, this is 4, from 3 comma 4. Step. Oh yeah. X and H, sorry, small. So, from 3 and 4, we get X and X inverse belongs to N, comma, XH X inverse belongs to H, implies by definition of NH, whenever there are two elements which are there in the respective sets, then the product automatically belongs to NH. This implies, what is this equal to? From 3, from 2, this product is nothing but x, y, x inverse belongs to NH. This is from 2. Therefore, x, y, x inverse belongs to NH. For all x in g for all y in x comma y are arbitrary. Just like that we have chosen. We have not assigned any value for them. Therefore, by definition, NH is number of g comma dot. NH is equal to HN. We know NH is equal to HN. This implies HN is also a normal sum. Therefore, product of two normal subgroups is always a normal sum. Therefore, product of normal subgroups is a normal sum. Product of normal subgroups is a normal sum of g comma dot. Next, we have again another important result. You can see this question again in the previous papers. If M capital M and capital N, exactly you can find same question. If capital M and capital N are two normal subgroups, capital M and capital N are two normal subgroups of a group G, two normal subgroups of a group G such that M intersection N is equal to singleton U. Very important. Why M intersection N cannot be empty? Because both are subgroups of the same group, identity must be there in both of them, inevitably. But if that is the only element which is common, then every element of M commutes with every element of every element of M. If singleton E is the only element, see, we know that E must be common to both M and N because both are subgroups for the same group. Because they are subgroups of same group, E must be there in M, E must be there in N. But M intersection N is singleton E, that means there exists no other element common other than E, then we have to prove every element of capital M, the set capital M commutes with every element of capital M. So how to prove this? Let us see. Proof. So given M comma N are normal subgroups of g comma n. So we know what are all the things, the definition, nth condition, whichever we want we can use. And also given M intersection N is singleton. That means what is the only element which is common to both M and N is singleton E. That means by chance X belongs to M intersection N, then that X must be equal to E itself because no other element is common except a singleton. Now, what is to be proved? To prove that every element of M commutes with every element of M. How to prove that? Small m into n is equal to n into m for all m in m, for all n in n. This is what is to be proved. Commutative means every element of capital M commutes with every element of capital M. Elements of capital M are denoted by small m, elements of capital N are denoted by small m. Sufficient to prove that Mn into Nm inverse is equal to E. What do you say? Sufficient to prove this. If you can prove Mn into Nm inverse is equal to E, then by retracing the step operating Nm on both the sides, we can get back this result. To prove that Mn equal to Nm, sufficient to prove Mn into Nm inverse is equal to E. If you can prove, then operating Nm on both the sides, we can get back this result. This is the idea behind this. Now, let me conclude. Nm inverse. Unknown. We have to prove. I am operating Nm on both the sides. That is, I am operating Nm inverse on both the sides. Sufficient to prove Mn Nm inverse, which is equal to Nm Nm inverse, is equal to E. That is, Mn into Nm inverse is equal to E. Sufficient to prove. It will be there because N is there in N. N is a complex subgroup. It will be there in G. And M is there in M. M is there in G. Subset, it is there. By closure, Nm will be there in G. By inverse, Nm inverse will be there in G. So you can operate and get sufficient to prove that. Now look at this again. How to prove that it is there in E? You know M intersection N equal to singleton U. So to prove that it is equal to E, sufficient to prove that, look at the argument. So to prove that it is equal to E, E is here. So sufficient to prove that this element is there in M intersection. So somehow applying some definition, something, if you can prove that this is there in M intersection N, then automatically we get that it is equal to E. So now our problem is solved if you can prove that this element is there in M intersection N. But to prove that it is there in M intersection N, we must prove that it is there in M as well as it is there in M. So now our aim is to prove that this element is there in intersection using normal subgroup properties. Somehow try to prove that this element total is there in M intersection N. That means you have to prove it is there in M and it is there in M. If you can prove, then we are through. So let us see how to prove this. So consider the element. So consider Mn into Nm inverse for any M in M which is subset of G, N in N which is subset of G. How do you know they are subsets? Because they are complexes. Why they are complexes? Being normal subgroup. Okay, for any, because we have to prove for every. Consider this for any. Now this is equal to Mn into, what is Nm inverse? M inverse N inverse. Shoe-socks property. So this is, because N is there in G, M is there in G, G comma dot is a group, implies by shoe-socks property Nm inverse is M inverse N inverse. Now, associative law, M, N, M inverse, N inverse. I am regarding this as one single element. Whichever one you are regarding it as one single element, use bracket for that. So you can apply associative law. This is in which form? A into B into C. So A, B into C by associative law in G. This is by associative axiom in G comma dot. car. M, N, M inverse, N inverse belongs to G.
All of them are there in G. For all
M comma I, by inverse act.
By
inverse act. How do you know M inverse, N inverse are there in G? By inverse acts. Okay, now this is this. Regard this as one single element. Okay,
now where is my M?
So give some number 1.
Did we give number anywhere? No, number 1.
Oh, number 1 somewhere? Yeah, this is number 2. 2.
Now look at that element. Where is small m?
You know that small m is there in capital M, which is subset of G.
Where is n?
It is there in N. Comma, what is n? It is a normal subset of G comma dot. Implies M, N, M inverse belongs to N.
Why the definition?
Now, also, N is there in N implies, comma, N is a subgroup. Why it is subgroup? Being normal subgroup. Being normal subgroup of G implies by inverse axiom or NS condition, there exists an inverse in N such that N dot N inverse is equal to N inverse dot N equal to. Agreed?
Now,
where is M N M inverse? It is there in N. M N M inverse is there in N, comma N inverse is there in N, comma N is a subgroup. Being NSG implies by closure axiom M N M inverse dot N inverse belongs to M. This implies M N M inverse N inverse belongs to M. This implies by 2. What is this equal to? This is nothing but M N N M inverse belongs to M. Give some number. What is the number we have to give for this? 3.
So somehow we have proved that it is there in N. Now we have to prove that it is there in M. So
also MN NM inverse is equal to, simplify again, M inverse into N inverse again by for all, because NM inverse is, we have given already explanation there. So M in M, which is subset of. Okay. Now earlier, what did we do? We have regarded this as one single element, and then we applied associative law A dot B dot. Now regard this as one single element. This is in which form now? A dot B dot C again. Earlier look at that. M n we have regarded as one single element. Here I am regarding this as one single element in G. Apply again associative. This is by associative as in G, comma dot, for all M in M, which is subset of G, N in N, which is subset of G, M inverse in G, N inverse in G. Now, when you look at it, regard this as one single element now. We already know this is there in M. M is there in M, we already know. We have to prove this is also there in M, so that the product will be there in M by closure. So, this is the idea behind this. MN into NM inverse. Give some number. 4.
Now,
how to prove this? you know to some extent. M is there in M, M is there in M, comma M is a subgroup of G comma dot implies M inverse belongs to capital. And MM inverse is equal to M inverse M is equal to E by inverse as. Okay. Now, M inverse is there in M. Where is N? N is there in N also. Comma, N is subset of G. M inverse is there in M. Implies N is there in G. M inverse is there in M. Now, N is there in G. M inverse is there in M. Comma, M is a normal subgroup of G. Implies N, M inverse, inverse of first one belongs to M. Agreed? Definition. This is in the form X, G, X inverse belongs to M. Whenever M is normal subgroup. Instead of X, we are having small n. Instead of M, H, small h, we are having M inverse. Now, we know M inverse is the, this one, M is there in M. We know, comma, N, M inverse, N inverse is there in M, comma, M is a subgroup. Implies subgroup of G comma dot implies M dot N, M inverse, N inverse belongs to M. By which axiom? Closure axiom. Which implies from 3. What is 3? I have to give 3 here. There is not 4. From 4, this is nothing but we get M N, M inverse, N inverse belongs to capital N M N into M N into N M inverse belongs to capital. Because this value is nothing but mn into nm inverse. This is what we have got. This is there in m we got. This is nothing but equal to this. Give some number 5. From 4 and from 3 and 5 also we know, already we know this is there in n. Now that we have proved it is there in m. So, it should be there in m intersection. Therefore, from 3 and 5, from 3 comma 5, we get Mn into Nm inverse is there in M and Mn Nm inverse belongs to M. This implies by set theory, whenever an element is there in both, it should be equal to it, which is equal to singleton E by 1. So, this contains only one element. So, this is an element in this. So, it must be equal to E. Is it not? It is like a bag contains only white balls. So, whenever you take a ball, it has to be white in color only, because that bag does not contain any other element other than white. It is also like that. M intersection N contains only one element E. If you take any element from that, it has to be equal to identity only, because there is no other element other than that. So, this implies operating on both the sides, Nm is equal to E into Nm, which implies Mn into E, E into Nm, Mn equal to Nm for all M in M, for all N in N, as they are arbitrary. Therefore, every element of capital M commutes with every element of carotenin. Every element of capital M commutes with every element of capital N. We have another concept here based on this called simple group. When is a group said to be simple? So let us see. Take down the definition. Simple group. Very important. Try to practice. Particularly this chapter theorems, try to analyze. Don't memorize. First, see, we are using only basic concepts to prove two sets are equal. One is subset of the other. Take an element here, try to prove there. You know how to manipulate. So you do that. Only that part you have to see and to practice. That's all. So take that. You're having that talent, isn't it? So that you see, only thing is using definition, how to arrive at that. Using and subgroup definition. Now, simple group. Quickly let us close this. Simple group. Take down the definition. And a group is said to be simple. A group G comma dot is said to be simple. Simple group if it has no proper normal subgroups. No proper normal subgroups. So, no proper normal subgroup means it should have only improper or trivial subgroups. What is meant by trivial normal subgroup? Yesterday we have seen whether other normal subgroups exist or not. There always exist two normal subgroups for any group. Namely, this is always a normal subgroup. This normal subgroup is what is called trivial normal subgroup. And every group is normal subgroup of itself, and this is called as improper normal subgroup. That means a group should have only improper and trivial. If these two are the only normal subgroups, then we call such a group as simple. So this we have seen somewhere yesterday. If every group is of prime order, Lagrange's theorem application, every group G has no proper subgroups. For anything to be normal subgroup, first it has to be subgroup, then normal. So if it is of prime order, then it will have only two subgroups, namely trivial and improper. Therefore, every group of prime order is automatically simple. Very important. Take down the theorem. Prove that. Every group of prime order is simple. Is simple. Or what is the contrapositive of the statement? P implies Q is equivalently same as saying negation Q implies negation P. That means if G comma dot is not a simple group, if a group G comma dot is not a simple group, then order of G is not prime. Not prime means composite. That is, order of G must be composite. That is, order of G must be composite. Converse need not be true. What is the converse? Because it is simple group, you cannot say it is of prime order. We cannot say converse, but we can say contrapositive. Now let us try to prove this theorem. So R you may be given. Prove that a group of order, a group of order, or every group of order 31 is simple. Question may be given like this.
Prove that any group of order 31 is simple. Question may be given like this.
Then you should get the idea that it is nothing but this theorem. 31 is nothing but prime number. How to prove that any group is simple?
If it is a prime order, automatically simple.
So if you can identify that this 31 is a prime number, every group of prime order is simple, this theorem. In this theorem, wherever P is there, I am going to use P. In place of P, substitute 31 and then repeat the process. Clear? So this is fourth theorem we are doing on prime order. Remember all the four theorems important. Every group of prime order is cyclic. First theorem we have proved. Every group of prime order is abelian, because every cyclic group is abelian. Every group of prime order have no proper subgroups. Yesterday Lagrange's theorem application. Every group of prime order is simple. This is the theorem. Okay, practice these theorems. Now take down the proof.
Proof.
Let G comma dot be the given group. Be the given group with the order of G is equal to some small p where p is prime. P equal to prime number. Now, what is to be proved? Let claim. What is to be proved? You have to prove that G is simple. G is a simple group. Sufficient to prove that. Sufficient to prove that G has no proper normal subgroups. Sufficient to prove that G has no proper normal subgroups. That is, sufficient to prove that H equal to singleton E or H is equal to G are the only normal subgroups. No proper normal subgroups, these two are the only normal subgroups. Normal subgroups of G comma dot. So let H comma dot be any subgroup of G comma dot. Any means some arbitrary. Now this implies by Lagrange's theorem order of H divides order of G, which is small p. Lagrange's theorem says whenever you take a subgroup, if H is subgroup, order of H divides order of G. Now order of H divides P, comma P is prime, P is a prime number, implies what are the only divisors of prime number? 1 or itself are the only divisors, which implies what is P, which is order of G, which implies H is equal to singleton E or H is equal to G as H is subset of. See, cardinalities are equal does not imply sets are equal, but H is a subset of G being subgroup. So order of subgroup will be equal to order of the group only when they are one and the same. Otherwise no. So therefore H equal to singleton E comma H equal to G are the only subgroups. There exist no other subgroups. If it is a subgroup only, it will become normal subgroup. There exist no other subgroups, we are saying. Therefore, these are the only subgroups. And we know H equal to singleton G and H equal to G are normal subgroups of G comma dot called trivial and improper. therefore h equal to singleton e comma h equal to g are the only normal subgroups of g comma, which implies g has no proper normal subgroups, which implies g comma dot is a simple group. Indirectly, question may be given sometimes. If g comma dot is not a simple group, prove that its order must be prime. Then also, after proving this theorem, then we must write contrapositive. Therefore, order of g is equal to prime implies g comma dot is simple. So every group of prime order is simple. So every group of prime order is simple. So if you are asked to prove every group of order 31 is simple, wherever p is there, write simply 31. Just replace p by 31. Whatever prime number that is given, you just copy paste. Replace wherever p is there by 31 or 17, 13, whatever prime number that is given, just simply. Is it clear? Now, suppose you are asked to prove the other way. After proving this, this is the end of this theorem. Suppose you are asked to prove, if it is not simple, then it must be of composite order. Then, after proving this theorem, you have to write one more. We know P implies Q is equivalently same as saying negation Q implies. Write one more statement. After proving this theorem, write one more statement. Then we get negation Q means, that is g comma dot is not a simple group implies g comma dot is not a prime order. Not of prime order means it must be of composite order. Is of composite order. If you are asked to prove that G must be of composite order, if it is not simple, then extend, try to use this. Okay? Now, with this, we can close only normal subgroups, but extended concept is. So, this has given rise to a type of group called quotient group. So, take down this quotient set. Then we don't know. May be simple, may not be simple, need not be simple. We don't know. There is a theorem. Actually, that syllabus they have removed from your this one civil services syllabus. There is a theorem called that is Sylow's theorem. So Sylow's normal subgroups, very interesting. Sylow's first theorem, second theorem, third theorem. Using that, you can prove that composite order also may be simple sometimes. May be simple sometimes. What are all the normal subgroups also you can get using Sylow's theorems. But fortunately or unfortunately got removed. So your question is half answered. So it is. Composite order means may be simple, may not be simple, we don't know. Okay. So that is there in before 2010, 11 question has come. You know, composite order, that is some 32 is not simple. They are asked to prove. That is before 2011. After 2011, syllabus got changed. So, before that if questions are there, at that time Sylow's theorems work. Therefore, using Sylow's theorem we have established. But now, we are not able to. Now, anyway, 2011, before 2011. Now, let us try to prove this quotient set. Let g comma dot be a group. If you are interested personally, you come, I will prove using Sylow's theorem. If you still, if you are interested. Let g comma dot be a group, comma, HB a normal subgroup of G comma. Then quotient set of H in G, quotient set is denoted by G by H slash. Some textbooks they write like this, denoted by this and defined by set of all either right cosets or set of all left cosets. If it is with respect to G comma dot, it is with respect to G comma plus. See, whatever we are doing with respect to dot can be extended to plus also, if plus is binary operation. So if it is under plus, how it is defined? H plus A. A belongs to G. A plus H, A belongs to set of all either right cosets or left cosets. You know that set of all left right cosets is same as left cosets. Why? Because H is normal subgroup. Because H is normal subgroup, each left coset is equal to its corresponding right coset. So whether you write set of all right cosets or set of all left cosets, it is the same set which is G by. And this is defined only when H is normal. Otherwise, quotient set is not defined. Okay, now this we already know how to multiply two cosets. Whenever H is normal, yesterday we have proved theorem HA dot HB is equal to HAB. So how coset multiplication is defined? How to multiply two cosets? Simply multiply the elements. The product of two right cosets is again a right coset. Product of two left cosets is again a left coset, whether under addition or under multiplication. So then using that as the binary operation, now we know how to multiply. There is a dot that is defined. So this quotient set along with that operation is going to form a group. Such a group is what is called quotient group. Okay, take down that theorem, quotient group theorem, very very important. Again, this concept again we are going to extend in ring theory. Again, I'll be quoting often that we have proved so and so theorem. You must be able to please go through the theorems, if not proofs, statements. Okay, what are the members of this set? All, whether equal, unequal, distinct, not distinct, all. For example, before going to this, if you want to have some clarity, if G is equal to 1 minus 1 I minus I, H is equal to 1 comma minus 1, then find G by H. Suppose you are asked to constitute the quotient set. Then according to definition, G by H is set of all HA where A belongs to G. G contains 4 elements. So in place of A, you can substitute 4 elements. A equal to 1 minus 1 I minus I, H1, H minus 1, HI, H. These are the members. But we know the story that all are not distinct. We know. So we write all elements. When we count how many elements are there in G by H means, we say it is only 2. So that means what is the cardinality of G by H means? Only 2. Because when we count cardinality, cardinality is defined as number of distinct elements. You know that H1 is same as H minus 1, HI is same as H minus I, earlier we have proved. So these two are one and the same, these two are one and the same. How many distinct means 2, but how many elements are there, what are the elements means, you list out all. Is this your doubt? Yeah. So we include all. Next one, let us go for now quotient group theorem. State and true quotient group theorem. Quotient group theorem. If G is, if G comma dot is a group, comma H comma dot is a normal subgroup of G comma dot, comma A comma B belongs to G, then G by H comma dot is a group called quotient group with respect to dot defined by HA dot HB is equal to H AB for all AB in G.
This is called coset multiplication. With respect to plus, then H plus A plus H plus B is equal to H plus A plus B. So that is also a group. Now second part in this. If G is abelian or commutative group, then prove that G by H comma dot is also abelian. Next, second part, this is first, second, third one. Prove that order of G by H is equal to index of P. What is index? That is equal to order of G by H. Also prove that order of G by H is order of G by order of H. This total story is when it is finite group. If it is infinite, we cannot do anything. He is a finite group. Then only we can talk about orders. Let us try to prove quickly. So, proof. We are asked to prove only group, write only first statement. Proof of one. We are asked to prove it is abelian only, go to second statement. Ask to prove third only, go to the third. All the three are independent. So now what is given? Given G comma dot is a group. Comma H is a normal subgroup of G comma dot. Now, G by H. By definition, G by H is set of all either right cosets or left cosets by definition, and also given H A dot H B is equal to H A B for all A B in G. So what is to be proved? To prove that, let X Y Z belongs to G by H be arbitrary. Because we have to prove it is group. Group means we have to prove closure, associative, identity, inverse, all the four axioms. So this implies X will be in which form? Every element in this is of the form a coset. Y will be in the form HB. Z will be in the form HC. Where A, B, C, they are there in G. By definition. Now closure axiom. So we can use these three for all the axioms. So consider X dot Y. When is an element going to be in G by H? Provided it is right coset. And when is it going to be right coset? It should be in the form H into something. This something should belong to G. So consider X dot Y. X A dot H B. H into A B. Where A B belongs to G. For all A comma B belonging to G and is unique as G comma dot is a group. Because G is a group, we already know by closure axiom in G, whenever A comma B are there in G, A B belongs to G by closure axiom, and it is unique because dot G is group means the operation in that is binary operation. A B means what? A dot B. What is that dot? As defined in G. Suppose, how many dots will put? So, according to the context, we have to understand. If all of us want to have distinct names, difficult. In the world, population is so much. At least one name repeats. Similarly, according to the context, because of the name, we are not calling by, there is no confusion. Similarly, based on the dot, based on the context, we understand our dot. Wherever Sachin appears, we don't think he is a cricketer, isn't it? Only in the cricket ground, with respect to that particular subject, we call him
we cognize him like that. In some other field, same name, but we cognize him as that person with respect to that field. There is no confusion in names. Similarly, the binary operations also. So, if it is in Z6, we understand dot means into 6. If it is in Z5, we understand it is modulo 5. If it is in real number system, we understand that it is multiplication of real numbers. So, AB means, in G means, A dot B in G. What is dot? As defined in G. How many operations will write otherwise, you tell me. Is it not? Therefore, like this. You understand? Okay. So, this is the one. This is AB in G. You know, what is AB means? A dot B. What is dot? Not this dot. The dot as defined in G. Clear now? Right. So, tomorrow, it should be clear. Tomorrow, when I do the problem, then you will face actual problem. So, let us see. Today you can be happy. So, HAB, there AB is there in G. So, because it is in the form HAB, where AB is there in G, it is a right cosine. Therefore, automatically X dot Y belongs to G by H and dot is unique. Therefore, it is a binary operation. Dot is binary and G by H comma dot is closed. Next one, associative acts. Associative. So, what is to be proved? We have to prove that X into Y into Z, X into Y into Z, for all X, Y, Z belonging to G by H. Now consider LHS, HA dot, HB dot, HC. First we evaluate which is within bracket. What is HB into C? HBC. Definition of cosets multiplication. How to multiply two cosets? Simply multiply the elements, BC. Now use this bracket. That means we are regarding this as one single element. So HA dot BC. Because HA dot HB is HA. A dot B, coset multiplication. How is multiplication defined? Look at this. Wherever you get HAB, you can split this as HA into HB. Wherever you come across HA dot HB, we can write this as AB. Simply multiply the elements. Where ABC belongs to G. You know G is associative because it's a group. We can change the bracket AB dots. Because G by associative axiom. In G, by associative axiom in G domain, A dot BC is AB dot. Now we can split this, record this as one single element, use bracket, down bracket. You know HAB means HA dot HB. So what is HAB dot C means? HAB dot HC. This is HA dot HB dot HC. Which is X dot Y dot Z, which is R. Therefore, X dot Y dot Z, X dot Y dot Z, for all X, Y, Z, in G by H. Therefore, G by H comma dot is associated. It is a semi-group. Or one more step, XYZ belongs to G by H as XYZ dot arbitrary. How can we say that it is true for every? Because the arbitrary. Next one, identity acts. Let E be identity of G comma dot. Consider, then this implies E belongs to G and A dot E equal to E dot A equal to A for every A in G. We know. This implies HE belongs to G by H. Because whenever A is there in G, HA is there in G by H. So So whenever E is there in G, HE is there in GY.
Now
consider HA dot HE. Consider HA dot HE. It can be rewritten as HAE, which is HE, because AE is equal to. Also, HE dot HA is equal to HEA, which is HA, because EA is equal to. Therefore, HA dot HE is equal to HE dot HA is equal to HE, which implies X dot HE is equal to HE dot X is equal to X. Therefore, HE is the identity of GY. So whenever E is the identity of G, HE is the identity of GY. HE, which is nothing but she is saying H itself. That is, HE is the identity of GY. Because E belongs to H, implies HE equal to H, which is E. HE is nothing but H itself. So whenever E is the identity of G, H dot E will be the identity of G by H, which is nothing but H itself. So whenever you have quotient set, the denominator will give you directly the identity. Remember this. G by H, H is the identity. Suppose it is the group Z6 by Z2, Z6 slash Z2, then Z2 is the required identity. You can also write HE or you can also say H. Next one, inverse. Inverse of the element. So, inverse axiom. Inverse axiom. A belongs to G imply, comma G comma dot is a group. We know implies is a group, implies there exists A inverse such that A dot A inverse is equal to A inverse dot A is equal to E. This we already know. Now A inverse is there in G implies H A inverse belongs to G by H. Because inverse and identity, they must be there in the set. Then only we can call it as group inverse. Are you getting the point? Why I am insisting you to mention this? This is the crucial point. Because identity may exist. If it is outside the set, we say it is not group identity. Natural number system, 1 plus 0 is 1. But we say 0 is not the identity because 0 does not belong to N. So identity, if it exists, must belong to the given set. Therefore, it is must condition to prove that HE belongs to G by. Similarly, inverse also must belong to given set. Then only we can call it as group inverse. Otherwise, we say inverse does not exist in that particular set. So, this is the one. Now, also HA dot HA inverse is equal to HAA inverse, which is equal to HE. Similarly, HA inverse into HA is HA inverse A, which is HE, because A inverse into A is E. Why? Because already explanation given. Therefore, HA dot HA inverse is equal to HA inverse dot HA is equal to E. Therefore, HA inverse is the inverse of HA in G by comma dot. So inverse exists for all the elements. Which one? H. H, yeah. H, correct.
Yeah.
It is the identity in that set. Now, last, therefore, G by H comma dot is a group. So with this we have completed one part. What is the second part? If G is abelian, we have to prove G by H is also abelian. So, what is abelian property? Given G comma dot is abelian or commutative, anything which implies A dot B is equal to B dot A for all A B in G. To prove that G by H comma dot is abelian, we have to prove that, sufficient to prove that X dot Y is equal to Y dot for all X Y in G by H. If you are asked to prove it is abelian group, you must prove all four axioms of group. Don't simply write this. Don't be too smart. Okay, first we have to prove it is group. Four axioms, then prove abelian. Okay, so let us try to prove this. LHS H dot Y HA dot HB HAB by definition. This is HBA because from 1 AB is equal to BA. This is HB dot HA coset multiplication Y dot S, which is R. Therefore, X dot Y equal to Y dot X are all XY in G by H. As X comma Y are arbitrary, what are they? Already we have chosen in the beginning. We know what are X and Y. Next one, therefore G by H is abelian. So therefore G comma dot is abelian implies. So G comma dot is abelian implies G by H comma dot is also abelian. Last, we have to prove order of G by H. So what is order of G by H? Cardinality of G by H. Number of distinct. What is G by H? G by H contains set of all cosets. So, cardinality of G by H contains number of distinct left or right cosets. Because what is G by H? Set of all cosets. So, when we count cardinality, we count only distinct. So, number of distinct left or right cosets. But we know number of distinct left or right cosets is given a name called index. Index of H. That is IHG. By Lagrange's theorem, it is equal to order of G by Lagrange's theorem. We know Lagrange's theorem has got two forms. Order of subgroup divides order of G. Not only that, index is equal to order of G by order of H. Therefore, order of G by H is equal to order of G by order of H. So, this completes this chapter. S5 is the set of all permutations. S5 is the set of all permutations on 5 symbols. On 5 symbols. Find the index of the cyclic subgroup generated by 1, 2, 4 in S5. Find the index of the cyclic subgroup generated by 1, 2, 4 in S5. So question is linking permutations, that quotient group index, and then cyclic group. All the three linked bit. So let what is group G S5? What is H? Generated by 1, 2, 4. This is, let us call this as some sigma. This is generated by this sigma. H is equal to generated by this particular sigma. Then we want index. What is index? Index of H in G is nothing but order of G by order of H. What is meant by index? Number of distinct left cosets or distinct right cosets. This is index. Order of G by order of H. What is G is equal to S5? So we know what is order of S5. What is order of G? Order of S5. What is this equal to? 5 factorial, which is 120. S5 is not 5. Order of S5 is, it is symmetric group. Order is 5 factorial. Set of all, what is S5? Recall, set of all permutations defined on S. What is S? A set containing 5 symbols. What is meant by symbols? A1, A2 and so on up to AN. Or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, come back to this. This is order of G. Symmetric group of order N. SN. Order of SN is N factorial. There are N factorial bisective maps which are defined. Each bisective map is a permutation. Now, come back to this. We want order of H. So, we know that order of a subgroup, this is nothing but order of the generator. Because H is generated by sigma, we know that order of the group is same as order of its generator. So, order of H is same as order of sigma. How to find order of sigma? Sigma is equal to disjoint cycle. It is a cycle. And if there is a product of two disjoint cycles, then LCM of that will give you the order, order of the permutation. Order of the permutation is defined as the LCM of the disjoint cycle, if it expressed as disjoint cycles. If there is only one cycle, length of the cycle itself gives you the order of the permutation. Long, long ago we studied all this. So applying that, this is order of sigma. What is order of sigma? It is nothing but length of sigma. What is meant by length? Length is nothing but number of symbols which are present in the cycle. How many symbols are present in the cycle? 3 symbols. So, order of H is equal to 3. You need not find what is H and count how many distinct. Because it is cyclic group. Otherwise, how to find order of any group? Number of distinct elements gives you the order of the group. But in this particular case, it is generated by sigma. And sigma here is a cyclic permutation. Therefore, order of this, because it is cyclic, order of the group is same as order of the cycle, order of the element. Element is a cycle, only single cycle is there. So, length of the cycle directly gives you the order of this. Now, order of G is known, order of H is known. So, what is the index? Order of G by order of H, 120 by 3, which is equal to, see the bit, dimension of this. Clear? Next one. If sigma is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 1, 3, 4, tau is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 4, 1. Find cyclic groups generated by sigma and tau. Find cyclic groups generated by sigma and tau. Find cyclic groups generated by sigma and tau. So, it is under multiplication because we know permutation is a group under a dot. So, let us take G is equal to sigma generated by sigma, where sigma is 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 1, 3, 4. Now, according to definition, this is generated by this means how to get the elements? Sigma, sigma square, like that, n belongs to set. If it is under multiplication, n into a. If it is under addition, n into a. If it is under multiplication, a power n. So, sigma power n. So, how to find sigma power n is sigma, sigma square, sigma cube and so on. So, we have to start our journey with a sigma. We have to continue our journey until we get identity permutation. So, when are we going to get identity permutation? If n is the least positive integer such that sigma power n equal to I, then n is called as order. Until we get that, we are going to continue our journey. So, first find out the order of sigma. So, sigma is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. It is a cyclic permutation. When you write this as disjoint cycles, product of disjoint cycles, 1, 2, 3, 4. This is a cyclic permutation, product of the disjoint cycles. Now, length of the cycle is 2, 1, 1. So, what is the length? That is, what is order of sigma? Order of sigma is LCM of lengths. which is nothing but LCM of 2, 1, 1, which is 2. Therefore, order of, we know means some theorem. So, we know order of sigma is equal to LCM of lengths of disjoint cycles, which is equal to LCM of 2, 1, 1, which is 2. Therefore, sigma square is identity. What is identity permutation? 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So, what is the cyclic group generated by this G? How long we have to continue our journey? This is G is equal to sigma square. That's all. After that also you can continue, but you will get repeatedly same. So, this is sigma I. Therefore, G is equal to sigma comma I. Sigma square. This is the cyclic group generated by G. That's what you are asked to do. I think for tau you can do. So, proceed exactly same manner. So, cyclic subgroup generated by this is this. Next one. Yes. That's all. So, this is the connected bit. Again, we have to come back to cyclic groups later, permutation groups. Again, linked bits are there. After doing homomorphism, again, we will come back to this.